Sensei, you deserve that and even more. So, I'm very proud tonight. Good evening to you all. My name is Deborah. On behalf of Scoops Theatre of Books, we welcome you to Scoops. Those that have been here the first time, I'm very glad you're in the most magical place on earth, the only bookshop in Johannesburg you should be in. Because there isn't any other bookshops in Johannesburg that are worth visiting. Please like our Scoops Theatre of Book Facebook page, and obviously most of you know our esteemed author tonight, Marcus, and I'm sure, I hope that you guys are all on his Facebook page as well. We've done a lot of launches over the last year, but tonight for me is a very special one. We've launched authors from Zimbabwe, Nigeria, Ghana, Zambia. One of them is here tonight, Precious Nirambi. She's from Zimbabwe, Precious. She launched her book here, and then we've got Zahira Walker, who launched her book on Wednesday. Beautiful Chaos, which is available in the store, and Tony Cox, who actually writes the same genre as Marcus does, who launched her book last week, and then Elemental Rising and Beautiful Chaos are in the store, and Precious is breaking forth as downstairs. Is it there, Presh? Did you check? Okay. And our esteemed guest Anusha and her friend from Our Magazine. Sorry, they're just having a quick meeting, but guys, Kim from Tango with Text is our resident blogger extraordinaire. Thank you for coming, guys. They come and support all these launches because that's what we do. We buy African from the DRC, Ghana, as I said, Zambia, Africa, and proudly so. What is the point of buying overseas books when we have got the most incredible authors on this continent? And I taught that as a collective whole. And what made it special for me tonight, I was introduced to Marcus by a gentleman that comes into our bookstore quite often and spends a lot of time reading the books and tells me he's got a book here. I don't know what a book here means, because I'm going to nag him till he writes the book, which he's told me tonight is going to be in a year's time. Not going to work for me. I'm going to kick his butt until he writes it. Guys, if you've got a special story, please write it down. There are people that want to read these stories. We should be reading these stories. And when he introduced me to Marcus, it was an honor to meet an author, an African author, that is writing in this genre. For me, this is a first at Scoops, and I scooped it immediately because of this. We don't get African authors that write in this genre. And it fascinated me that this beautiful young man, and you've got to admit, people, you know, when he came into my shop, and I'm going to tell you this, Marcus is actually getting married next month. Congratulations to both. Right? Yes. We actually planned this along the line of him getting married. And with his, in conjunction with his book being in London. Because he actually is international. Not just in Africa. So this was a well-planned event this evening. But he caused a stir when he came into my shop. This beautiful African man with a, you know, the French accent just kills every single woman on the planet. I'm telling the truth, guys. It just happens to be like that. Oh, mon ami. You do it for me. Je t'aime, mon ami. Pour toi. And it's fact, us girls are suckers for that. Cappuccino, what was that silly advert we used to have on the Wimpy Bar? Mochaccino, Choccaccino, and it's beautiful. And Then I hear, not only is he writing in a genre that you would never find, or really find, an African author to do, he is a martial arts expert, sensei, black belt. I mean, what's not for a girl to fall in love with? I mean, honestly. So there's me, gaga-eyed at 56 years of age, feeling like the luckiest girl on earth, meeting, and I told him, right there in the interview. And he had all the ladies agog in my bookshop. And I say this to you with respect, Marcus. Your presence is so powerful. Every woman dreams of this gentleman in her life, and he's here tonight, and I'm so proud to have him in my life. I was a bit scared because he didn't come and sort of come to the launches, but he has been in the last couple of weeks, and I thank you, Marcus, for attending. I think it's been, I need you here more often, and I know you're getting married next month, and I can't wait for my piece of wedding cake. You heard me, eh? I've never been married, so I'm allowed to be addicted to wedding cake, other people's wedding cake. My daughter's actually getting married on Sunday, so I'm very thrilled about that. And it was such an honor to sit in Marcus's presence, because he spoke so beautifully. The illustrations in his book is done by Michelle.
Sharon.
Sharon, I do apologize. I don't know why I've got Michelle on the brain. That's why. By Sharon, and I was fascinated by the aspect of two people coming together and putting words to pictures, because that is, her art is on the wall. Isn't it just incredible? Tony Cox writes a book called Elemental Rising, and I know why she's here tonight, because they're almost writing a similar genres and the magic of things. My hashtag is hashtag stay in your magic. Stay in your magic. And I think, Marcus, this is what you've done. I think these are the questions you need to ask him. What on earth made this man? Where did these stories come from and the pictures to go with him? I can't wait to hear the story. I, Sensei, am honored. I am honored, Sensei, to have you in my life. I am honored to have your books in my store. Please, people, put it onto social media. Can we give Marcus a round of applause for writing the genre that he writes in? For being the kung fu, no, it's not kung fu. It is kung fu. I've got it right. The kung fu South African champion that he is, and the gentleman that he is. And I hope that your reading is going to be superb. And without any further ado, I'm going to hand you over to our MC for the evening, Michael. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to call Marcus in for his replacement. Okay, cool.
Well,
as Deborah said, my name is Michael, and I'm your MC for tonight's event. And without taking any time, I would like to introduce you to Michael, the boy. Okay, cool. Thank you very much. So, thank you for all of you for being here. We know that sometimes you've got duties to do, but you decided to come here, and we treasure that. Mark is very grateful for that. Thank you very much. So let's get started. Well, Marcus, I've got some background story questions to ask you. Well, can you please give us a quick story on your childhood? And I'm pretty sure that your childhood has affected or inspired your writing style. Can you please tell us something about it?
Thank you, everyone. It's my joy and privilege to see many of you coming tonight. I thank you all for being here. Well, just to follow the program, because if I have to start saying the thank yous now, it will take quite a while. And we'll get into that a little bit later. So following the protocol, I'm going to give a little bit of answer on Michael's question here. Well, storytelling is my world since I was a little child. Growing up in the DRC, I was born in Lubumbashi, which is the second biggest city of the DRC. And I had the privilege to live in a city that wasn't very far from my mother's home village. And we often traveled with my parents during holidays when I was a child into the village, you know, where it is really the awesome Africa. I know why I'm saying awesome, because life is so peaceful there. You can go for walks, fishing, hunting, just standing in the grass. So many beautiful things going on there. So at that time, I used to spend a lot of time with my grandfathers, my grandparents, and I used to nag them a lot about stories. And there's so many stories, so many African stories that they told me about. And I took that time listening to them, just fascinating stories, very similar to, you know, the accounts that we know, Snow White and all the others, and there's so many of them. And I remember I wouldn't let them, you know, I wouldn't let them go to bed at night without telling me a story. So I used to nag them. And I think that put something in me, and I became a fan of telling stories. And I used to tell stories, making up stories to my brothers and sisters, to my parents, telling them stories for days, for hours, make them laugh in the house. And I know they hear, they can obviously tell you about this. I used to make them, spending time with them a lot. And also another part that also inspired me in my writing was a period in the country where we went into transition. It was a time where we moved from Zaire, because that's what was DRC before it became DRC. And it was a time of conflict, time of war, and time of bullets flying, and time of, you know, a lot of chaos. And it was a time where you're looking for comfort and a sense of protection, you know. In your imagination, you're thinking, you're praying that something shouldn't happen to your family, to your father, to your mother. And I think that gave me a sense in the style that I'm writing today.
Thank you very much, Marcus. Thank you. Another question I have right here is about your educational background. Did the education you received back in the Congo and, let's say, in part here in South Africa shaped you into becoming the heart of who you are? Thank you.
Well, thank you. I'll say yes. You know, most of my family members, my friends who are present here come from the DRC. We have quite a different system back home. And it's a country where we have like a handful of books. You know, when I'm talking about subject in school, it's not six, not seven, not four. Pre-primary school, we had 12 to 14 subjects, which including history, music, geography, calculus, you know, all these kind of things. And high school, we had close to 22 subjects, you know, and you have to do all of it. Geography, music, and stuff. So we had a lot of knowledge, you know, like we read books from, you know, authors, big authors. We read history books, we read geography books, we had French, we had English in school, we had so many subjects. And I'm sure that gave me quite a big base upon which I got some good knowledge. And coming to South Africa was a nice experience for me, because I came here and I mastered, you know, the language, English, because I'm writing in English. It's very hard to write in French, believe me. It's not an easy language. So yeah, it's played a big part in shaping my abilities. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Marcus. I have another question, and I want to get a bit personal here, man. So, in your books, you talk about a lot of supernatural things, you know? So, I want to ask you, in your life, did you ever get a supernatural encounter? Please tell us.
Well, thank you. You know this one saying, I'm quoting myself, sorry guys. I often say that how controversial it is for one to deny that mankind is not from space while the earth itself is in space. It's a big question, isn't it? So if I was from Mars and I'm looking, I will see the Earth as a space planet. So most of us, we think that with this kind of separated from mystery, and we tend to look at the stars and dream about things that are up there. But we should remember that we are from space. We are in space because Earth is in space. And yes, I've had quite a few supernatural experiments of my own. I believe that there's more to life than see the heart, than meet the heart, as they say. When I was 10, I had malaria, and I literally was very sick, and I literally died for 45 minutes. And something magical happened, and there I was again. And that wasn't the only supernatural thing that I experienced. There was one time, I don't want to scare you guys, you know. I'm just sharing, I'm just answering your question here, all right? So there was one evening in the house where we were staying. Obviously, at that time, we didn't have electricity, so we used to have a generator. And we used to turn on that generator about 6 o'clock in the evening, and then we would turn it off around quarter to 11 or 10:30, somewhere there. And I and my big brother, who's not here, my elder brother, we used to attend to that, you know, because being elders in the house, obviously we had to do that. So one day, I went out to turn off the generator. And after I turned the generator, before I came out of the little house where the generator was covered, I saw a big bright light in the sky. And this was like around quarter past 10 at night. And as I came out, I looked at it. It was so bright, standing over there. And, you know, as I tried moving left or right, it moved. And I said to myself, I will race it. I went back into the small house and I start racing. And then that light just came down, and it was like a bright light all over the compound. And then after that, I found myself running again. And I entered the house, closed the house, and my dad came out of his bedroom like, "Mark, what are you doing?" I told him like, "No, dad, I just went to turn off the generator." And he said, "What?" I said, "Yeah, just turned off the generator." He said, "Okay, that's weird. The generator was turned quarter past 10. Now it's 2 o'clock. What happened?" That is a mystery. So these are ones of the supernatural encounters that I had. But I'll keep more for you. If you have questions, you can find them in the book.
Mysterious Marcus, isn't it? Okay, well, I'm going to the fourth question here. In your book one, you talk about a guy called Raymond. Do you find yourself related to that character? Because obviously, You come from the DR Congo, which is a sub-Saharan country, and you came to Johannesburg precisely. Isn't it you, man? Tell us.
Well, Raymond is a fictional character. He's an amazing guy, an innocent boy. Well, we'll get into the book a little bit later, but when you come to understand what the book is all about, he's a character that inspires me, and he's a character that struggles for life and love over many challenges that he encountered in his life. And I would say that Raymond is an inspiration to me, and many people who've read the book have easily related to the character themselves. So I wouldn't say that personally it's about me, it's not about me, but yeah, it's not per se, yeah. So it's not really, really like me in there, but it inspires me, yeah.
The last question on your background story is about finding out if you only find yourself in writing only about speculative fiction, you picture yourself trying to go into some other style?
Well, yeah, you know, speculative fiction is quite a broad style. There's a lot into it. You have fantasy fiction, science fiction, and yes, mystery, and so many other style. But to answer your question, no, I will not stop writing on the speculative fiction. I have already started working on other books, other work already. And one of them being kind of thriller, which is a story that's happening around South Africa in a business world. So it's not a fantasy story, it's a business story, but it's a mix of thriller and drama and love and all that, betrayal and stuff. And there's also other two books that I'm working on, which are more fantasy than Kazungu. And a superhero story that I'm busy working on right now.
Thank you, Marcus. So now we're getting into the part of Kazungul. That's why we're here, right? Yeah. Okay, well, what was the first question? It's about knowing why and how you came up with the name Kazungul. The second question is about giving us a brief overview. Tell us your story, man, of Kazungul, please.
Well, I came up with the name Kazungul. Well, it all started when I told myself, like I told you, I used to tell stories when I was a child. And it came a time where life got me so busy and I lost a little bit of that. And in 2012, I told myself I need to get back into this world. And I need to come up with something that will be pleasant to others. And I said to myself, I've always been a fantasy fan, and I want to do a story. I want to write a story, but I don't want to write just a story. I want to write a story. And I said, in the fantasy world, there's a lot of creatures, a lot of beings that we've met, and you've all been encountering them in movies, in books. You know, we talk about the vampires, the elves, the werewolves, and all these other creatures, angels, demons, and stuff. And I told myself that I would create a new being. I would create a being that never existed in the fantasy world. And this being of mine will not be neither demon or angel, nor vampire, nor werewolf, or elf, or angel. But it will be another race, different from that. So I started picturing in my head, what would this being be like? And I could see it clearly, I could see it. And I said, well, for any creature, you know, they say for any creature you need a name. And I told myself, which name will I give my picture? And at that time, I was working in the company that I'm working today, and I was between sales and logistics, and knowing the routes, seeing the routes from Joburg to DRC. There's a special place up north. It's a place where three countries meet together, like three in one. There's a border that joins three countries. You have Zimbabwe, you have Botswana and Zambia. And that place is called Kazungula border. And in that place, there's one of the seven wonders of the world, the Victoria Falls, which is very close by there. And I said it would be a nice name for me to name my creature after this mysterious triangle, I call it. And I said I'll call my creature Kazunguru. I just removed the L. So because there's a lot happening in the book that is connected to the Victoria Falls, to the Zambezi River, to the many African wonders, big forests up north, you know, the mounts, Kilimanjaro and all that. So I gave my picture an African flavor, and I came up with that name. Yeah. And to give a little bit of overview about Kazunguru. Kazunguru is a story that starts with a war in the heavens, and there's two armies that engage in a war. Beings of light that fight. We don't know the reason why they were fighting. I don't know the reason why they were fighting, but they were fighting. But then in the war, there's two soldiers that came to love each other, but they were from opposite sides. So there's Amael, who's one of the prince of Astoterus, which is a planet that is around the Sirius system. Sirius is the brightest star in our sky. So Astoterus is one of the planets around it. And Amael fell in love with Thais. And because of their love, they were rejected by the people. So they decided that because we don't want to be in conflict with you guys, we're going to move. So they left the heavens and they came to Earth. But when they came to Earth, they joined the being together. So you need to understand, like, Amael and Thais became one being. And that being named himself Adimas. And Adimas founded a family, started living in the land. He landed in the east of Africa, what's known as Africa today. And he became a great man. He fell in love with the land and he founded a family. But before Amael left his kingdom, his father cursed him. And that curse followed under his generation. And many years passed, in his generation, and this one young man who heard him, the name is Raymond, who comes, and he never knew that he was a descendant of Adimas. And while he started discovering the truth, found out that he was cursed and there was this demon that was haunting him. And that's a little bit of the story. So he starts discovering himself, trying to fight against the darkness, rising into the light. Yeah. So that's the overview.
Thank you very much. Another question I have here. In your book, there is one battle you call the War of Gog and Magog. The Bible also talks about that kind of war, but why did you decide to name one of the battles the War of Gog and Magog? Why?
Well, to make it clear, you need to understand that Kazunguru is a metaphor. It's a fantasy book, but it's a metaphor. And it talks a lot about human challenges. You know, we say that human, we are born from sin. For those who know this, we're born from sin and we struggle to try and get the salvation. So Kazunguru goes into that same scenario. It's a fantasy about human challenges, to strive for greatness and good over evil. And the war of Gog and Magog is just an illustration. It's a war that many people have been talking about. You know it as Armageddon, you know it as end of days, you know it as, you know, all these things. So I chose to include it in there to maintain the message of Kazungul, like what it's all about. Yeah.
Thank you. For those who have read the book, you'll find out that Marcus has decided to create so many characters. Why? Why so many characters? Can you please tell us?
Well, you know, fantasy is an endless world. For those who write in fantasy, they will tell you that it's endless. So there's no problem having so many characters. You know, if I was from Mars and I wanted to write a story about Earth, I would have to have 7 billion characters in my book, you know, because Earth is filled with 7 billion people, you know. So to make it real, I don't believe in stories as such as a standalone hero. There's never been anyone who could save or do anything by himself, you know. You always need support. And life is all about friendship, love, you know, sacrifice, and all the story. You know, you are born into a family, you can't born yourself in the world. You need to have people to have your back. So there's many characters in my book for that reason, because it's reality that life is full of people, and they have to have a place. Each one of them plays a role in our life. So that's why there's so many characters in the book.
Okay, thank you. You've written the book, Kazungo, well, you've got the manuscript. But now, can you please tell us what was your experience with getting publishers from the day you started up to the present day? Thank you.
Well, it wasn't easy. It wasn't easy to get a publisher. Well, when I started, I never thought about getting the story published until I was done with it. So when I finished, I was like, what's going to happen now, you know? What will happen now? So I started looking. I wanted to go firstly in a traditional publication way, you know, where you get a publisher, you find a publisher, you hand the manuscript, and then they just read through it and they call you to say, yo, you know, your story is great, come, and we're publishing you. But trust me, it's not easy. So I had my manuscript appreciated by 11 big publishers around the world, but all of them told me, sorry, you know, we don't just have space for your scripts. And I kept on pushing, I kept on trying, you know, because I was getting a little bit down. But coming from a martial art background, they always tell us that you never quit, you know, never quit, you never surrender. When you want something, you have to go. You have to go for it. So no retreat, no surrender. You know, they tell us once a Shaolin, always a Shaolin. So you have to go. So I kept that in my mind and I kept on searching until I found a publisher locally, and they worked on my book. And we got it published, but it wasn't there yet. I was feeling that there was an emptiness, because the distribution routes were somehow blocked. I couldn't get my book presented any place. You know, I had these copies with me, and you know what the point? You write books for people to read it, not to sit with them. So I kept on searching. Until one day, the publisher from overseas writes to me and tells me that we hear that you're looking for a publisher who would like to work with you. So I told them okay, and they gave me all the things and information and all that. So we started the work, and they published the first book later in 2014. And I was happy, you know, I was happy to see the book, you know, being available in many countries and online. I could go on Google and see how many, you know, online stores the book is presented and stuff like that. But there was still an emptiness because I'm here and there was nothing happening in South Africa about the book. And I told myself, it's not enough, you know. Online, you know, reading is not as big as big yet in the country. So with one of my friends, Mr. Louis, we've been talking, he's been a fan of Kazungul from the start. One day we were talking, he was asking me, you know, how is it going for your book? I told him, no, the book is good, you know, it's going well, it's growing, but it's growing only overseas, you know. I told him about the tour at the London Book Fair, which happened last month, and other tours that are coming in New York and Frankfurt and all that. But I told him, like, you know, but it's not moving here. Then he said to me, you know, I have someone that will help you with that. So he said to me, we need to go to Monte Cassino, to schools, and I will introduce you to someone who will assist you. Then I said, okay. But I've tried, but he said, no, you haven't met the right person. So I said, okay, I'll follow your lead. Then he told me, like, the day of the meeting, he was running late, he was caught up in traffic coming from North Gate, I think. And he said to me, go into Monte Cassino, go to Scoops, ask for Deborah, and tell her that Louis sends you, and tell her your story. Then she'll give you direction. And I came into here, you know, I was like, okay, you know. So I came in, I went to reception, I was like, I need to see Deborah. And she was down there counting books. They were doing some stock deck, I think. They said to me, no, you can go see her, she's there. And I went in there, for like 2 minutes, I was standing next to her, just looking at her. She was busy, you know, me, I don't like to disturb people. So I just standing, looking at her, but she was very busy there in the boxes, checking the books. And one of the guys at the counter there, left the counter, came in there and told her, like, there's this gentleman standing here, he's looking for you. Then she turned around, she looked at me, and she was like, yes, can I help you? I told her, yes, I'm actually here to see you. I'm an author and all that, and I introduced myself. Deborah just, you know, she just looked at me, she looked at the book, she heard what I had to say, she was like, where have you been all this time? You know, I hate stubborn authors like you, where have you been? I told her, like, I've been trying, you know. It's like, you haven't been trying here, you know. So she told me, like, no, we're going to help you, we're going to launch a book here. I will help you, this is what I do, I've launched a lot of authors. And that's how this journey started. It was in January. I think end of January, so we did some planning about it, and voila, here we are. Thank you, Deborah. Thank you. I'm so happy that finally in Africa there's a place where you can find Kazungul, and it's right here at Scoops.
Thank you, Deborah, for making this happening. Thank you. Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, we've come to the time where we need to introduce you to the amazing woman behind the drawings of Kazungul. Her name is Sharon Telling. Sharon, can you please join us? Okay. I believe you're fine, Sharon. Are you fine? Okay, good. Okay, cool. I've got a couple of questions for you here. The first one was, can you please share the experience you had while connecting to the Kazungul book?
Okay, Well, first of all, I just want to say thank you so much for everyone. We appreciate it all. It means the world to me. And thank you, Marcus, for bringing me on this journey with you. Because it's been crazy how we actually met, but it's been like 4 years, I think, something like that. But yeah, it's been amazing to bring your characters to life through your wonderful words, so thank you. And getting back to the question, so how did I connect with the book and the story? I think one thing that I really loved was this theme of destiny. So it was this sort of, you know, you read the book and you feel like you can be greater. There's something bigger out there. And I think I really connected with that in the sense of, you know, you can do amazing things if you just follow your path in life. And you can just be better. And yeah, so that's how I connected.
Thank you. The second question is, did you, while reading the book, somehow relate yourself to any character in the book?
I think I could relate myself to probably Natia, just because she was a mermaid, and that's pretty cool. And I think it's just she was sort of this innocent love struck girl at the start, and she actually turned out to be, you know, quite a badass.
Yeah.
I enjoyed her as a character, but she was awesome.
The last question is, well, you've been working with Marcus on this project called the Kazungul. And I would like to know, do you know where these projects can be landing? Like, what are your prospects in some of these projects you've been working on together?
Well, I'm hoping that we can eventually be looking to do a character bible, so we can get a book that just, you know, focuses on the illustration and bringing these characters to life, and also having the words in there, and then eventually a movie needs to happen. I think if you read the book, you'll read it and be like, wow, the imagery in this could be an incredible film. It could be the African Star Wars. No joke. It really is that good.
Yes, indeed. It's a good story. Thank you very much, Sharon, for your time. Thank you. Marcus, can you please come back? Give us some good applause, ladies and gentlemen. Look at the drawings. Give us some applause. Thank you. Yeah. That's good. Thank you very much. So, as you'll find, there are some booklets, and Marcus will be presenting where there are some characters. There is the Kazungul logo and the characters. If you can grab them and try to identify yourself, like, to get to know the characters inside the book. Thank you very much. I'm ending to Marcus, sorry.
Thank you, Michael. Yes, like we said, we've been working hard to try and give life beyond the words, and this has been the work of Sharon right there. You will see on the first cover that there's a logo, you know, like this is the patent, it's a brand. So that's the logo of Kazungul, you know. Like, you have many logos, Superman logo, this logo, so that logo, Star Wars logo. That is the Kazungul logo on top. And on the next page there, you will see this Raymond, the guy next to a spaceship. It's a three-star spaceship. And that Raymond, the young man that came to find out that he was part of the Kazungul, out of innocence, he was now embarked into this long journey. So that's Raymond right there in his spacesuits. And next to Raymond, after, you will see there's Queen Tenisha of Astra Taurus. This character actually is a mysterious character, because she is Nitya and she is Kepri at the same time. So as and when she's whole, she's Phoenicia, which is the queen of Astra Taurus. And next to that, you will see there's a drawing here. This one, it's Randolph. Randolph is, which is one of the companions of Raymond. And in that, it's a scene that happens in the book. He's busy defending Raymond. Raymond as a Kazungul down there against the Jumina Society. You'll find out who the Jumina Societies are. You know, they look scary with the copper mask on and the red tunic and stuff. And next to that, you will see this picture. It's Enoch Baati. He's Raymond's mentor. And he's the one that takes him and start teaching him on how to fight and all that. And you will see a beautiful creature on Enoch's hand there. That is called the Impundulu. In South African mythology, it's the Thunderbird. You know, they say that it's the bird of the Tokolosha and stuff like that. But in this story, it's different. The Impundulu helps Enoch in doing many wonders, you know. And next to that, you will see a dragon, an ice dragon. That is Darmus in his ice dragon form. Darmus is actually a phoenix, but until Raymond awakes him, he was caged as an ice dragon. But you will come to discover this when you read. And then you have the Shisha, which is this creature. They are like mountain nymphs. They live in caves and stuff, and in the book they actually live in the Modimolle mountain, you know. You find all the story in there. And you have the Nyami Nyami. This is Raymond Kazungul. For those who know, the Nyami Nyami is the guardian of the Zambezi River. Is a sacred creature to the Tonga people of Zimbabwe. That's the snake-like fish that you see there. So it's also part of the story. You come to discover it when you read. I love the Nyami Nyami part of the story as well. It's such a wonderful creature, character in my book. And then you have Princess Kaylin. This is a character from the second book. This is actually Enoch Baati's partner, wife, and she comes from a royal family, and that's Enoch right there, when he was still a young man, you know, when he was still in his prime, you know, and yeah. And next to him, you'll see there's Baba Zachary. Baba Zachary means, Baba means elder, actually, in my language and in many Central African language. So. Baba Zachary is Enoch Nento. So Enoch is Raymond's Nento, and Baba Zachary is Enoch's Nento. So he's the one who guides Enoch and protects him while he was still a little child and gives him guidance. And on the next page, you will see this blue creature. This is called Kanzunji. For those who come from DRC, they know what this is all about. It's a creature that haunts the forest, you know, and you can see his feet are facing backwards, you know. The feet are facing backwards. So it's one of the character in our mythology, but it plays a role in Kazungul. And then you have the artwork of the first book right there, while it was still, before it looked like what it looks today. So this was the drawing that Sharon made for the cover, the first cover. And then you have the second book cover when it was still an art. And I actually really, I really like them, you know, in like this. They look very, very good, very nice. And then the last image, it's Enoch Baati battling against the Owayo Shivo. And this happening in underworld, and in the part of the book, it's happening in the Yucatan Peninsula, in Czechoslovakia, one of the place where you have all the Chupacabra from the South American people and all that. So yeah,
this is it. Yeah.
Thank you, Marcus, for the correct presentation. We are now to the time of answering questions from the public, if you have any, please ask. Yes?
How did you and Sharon come to meet?
Oh, yes. That was actually going to be mentioned in my Thanksgiving. I met Sharon through a friend of mine, actually one of the first person to ever believe in Kazungu. He's my friend and he used to be my former colleague, but now he's working in the DRC. His name is Grant Clark. When I spoke to him about Kazungu, when I started writing the book, I told him like, man, you know, I'm writing this book and stuff like that. And he was supporting me. I used to tell him part of the book and all. And I told him, I had a challenge. I really want my book to be special, so I don't want to put any kind of cover. I want to have an artistic made cover for the book. And he told me that, you know what, I'll find an artist for you. So he went, and 3 days later he came and said to me, you know what, I found the artist actually. I told him, no way, how? And he said to me, like, you see, this is the one. So we went for a drive, we went to Botsburg, and we had a little meeting there, and he said to me, yes, here's the artist. And we were talking, and I showed Sharon the sketches. I won't even call them.